And so the next category here, as we're coming close to an end of the webinar, is the last category, and this is supporting technology changes. So as you know, Ignition's feature set is always improving. It's improving all the time, and we have underlying changes in some of Ignition's supported protocols and subsystems. And we decided to highlight a few of those here. So the authentication challenge is one that's nice for things like 21 CFR part 11 or other things that you have to have some sort of validated actions where somebody might need a supervisor to log in or at least put in their credentials to verify an action before you're able to write to a tag or make a change to a running system. Caching and sharing is a nice way that we've optimized certain actions so that you don't run, if you have 100 clients, you don't necessarily need to run the same logic 100 times. You can potentially have things set up where it's going to run a query a single time, for example, for all 100 of those clients, even if the 100 are looking at the same thing. Third-party OPC UA support, we added OPC UA redundancy, which is nice for if you're connecting to an external server that has support for that as it is inside the spec there. And we added project update scripts that are basically, they have better parameters to be able to integrate better with version control systems. So if you're committing your changes over to Git or another version control system so you can see the changes, it allows you to see who made those changes. You can log that type of information along with whatever commits that you might be making. Once again, Matt, over to you for a quick demo of these.
All right. So yeah, jumping into that first one there, the authentication challenge feature. So this was added so that way the operator that's using Ignition's interface here, say in perspective like this, if they need to make a change that requires a separate authentication, maybe from a supervisor, then they don't have to somehow log out, have the other user log in and then switch back over. So it's designed to be a little bit more kind of streamlined for that process. And so now the way that works is inside your event here, you can call an authentication challenge. You can provide a payload of information along with that. So when this gets triggered, it will end up calling a session event to respond to that session's authentication challenge here. So we can then take that payload and then do what we need with it, if of course it is successful there. So the user, the actual operator will actually just see that kind of interface pretty seamlessly through the standard kind of auth challenge, the experience that you would use for normal kind of logging in. So if I go to that page now and take a look at that, I can add whatever value I want here as essentially this is the payload essentially. I click the button to do the auth challenge. And if our IDP is cooperating with us today, it would trigger the login page here where we can log in and then continue on with that. So in the next kind of example that we have here is the cache and share option. So in any of our example pages here where we might be running, say, some kind of polling task or some kind of query task, say we had a table that had some kind of query binding on it, there's a new option that is enabled by default called cache and share. So you'll be able to take advantage of that. Of course, you can disable it if it makes sense for that given application. The way it works is whatever result's going to be returned based on this query for the set amount of kind of polling time here, we're actually going to cache that. So if you have multiple screens looking at the same query, there's no sense in re-querying the database, hitting that database multiple times over for the same exact kind of data. So we can easily just share that with all of the running screens that are looking at that same data. So that's definitely a good performance uplift there. The other feature that we've mentioned that's kind of the underlying support that may not be necessarily obvious just looking at it is the fact that with Ignition, we have an OPC UA server built in, and inside that we do have support for redundancy now. So third-party clients can actually connect into Ignition and then be able to fail over to the backup Ignition system with regards to OPC UA. So that means you can now fit Ignition into more highly available type of architectures. and then reliably fail over to that backup system. And we do have some settings here if you do want to configure that under the server settings, advanced options. So you can go through your own system and set that up. And then
one quick note there that I wanted to make is the, so in addition to the settings that Matt was just showing there that are, that have to do with ignitions redundancy and how the binding works there with the different OPC servers, the support for the OPC redundancy that is based on the OPC spec is actually not directly tied to what we're looking at here, but it is tied to OPC servers that we are connecting to. So for example, there's a number of different external software packages that have OPC servers that Ignition might be making an OPC UA connection to. Those servers potentially can implement that OPC UA spec that is the redundancy between the master and the backup that they have inside there. And that redundancy settings, those set of settings inside there, identify where the two different servers are. When the Ignition client is connecting to those, then it will automatically switch over from the main one to the backup one if it loses connection with the main one. And it now understands those pieces of the OPC spec. If you have a client connecting into Ignition, you can use the standard failover between if one fails, that you can go to the next one. And some of these settings are related to that, but it doesn't actually publish out those redundancy tags as of right now. Just wanted to make that clear. We are looking at adding that piece in the future, but I didn't want to lead anybody in the wrong direction here. So that was my only additional note here.
Yeah, Kevin, I believe that was released in 8.1.10. So I think good there. So I think we, at this point, we should have support for both server and client side, just overall for the OPC UA, which is definitely good. So yeah, so the last point here that we wanted to highlight is in the project settings here under the gateway events, we have an update event, which means anytime someone saves the project in the designer here, this event could be called with a standard Python script here. And we now include additional parameters so that way you know what resources were added, modified, removed, and who's the actor, who's essentially, you know, holds the user for, you know, responsibility for that update. Also, there's a Boolean here for if the manifest has changed. So essentially, if a change has been made to project settings on the gateway itself, there might not be an individual resource here. So using that information, you can now have better support for version control and maybe some automated auditing here so you can find out what's going on as the project gets updated there.